Hello friends, my name is Dr. Jayesh and I am working in Meenakshi Lab, Madurai. In this video, I will be explaining about establishment of PCR laboratory. In this video, I have given details of space and infrastructure, equipment details including their maintenance and calibration, reagent and consumable along with their quality checks and storage requirement, and I have also included details on laboratory wear. This video will provide a complete guide on seating of PCR laboratory. This video I have made out of my field experience and working exposure.
Over the past several years, the development of the PCR as the basic component of a molecular biology laboratory has occurred very rapidly. The PCR technique became indispensable in laboratories to amplify small amount of template nucleic acid. At the same time, it is learned that PCR had a strong susceptibility to contamination from its own product. A number of precautions are required to be adopted when designing a PCR laboratory such that the laboratory is operated in a way that prevents contamination of reactions with amplified products from previous assays and cross-contamination between samples, both of which can lead to false positive results. So, first of all, starting with the laboratory space arrangement, a PCR laboratory should contain two functional areas, a pre-amplification area and a post-amplification area. These two areas should ideally be in a separate room. Supplies and equipment should be dedicated to each work area and should not be interchanged between areas. A laboratory performing PCR analysis on diagnostic samples should be divided at least three physically separated rooms. Here you can see a sample structure I have shown here, where there is a pre-reagent preparation area, biosafety cabinet area and a PCR amplification area, along with the buffer areas and a pass boxes from where the product of one room can be transported to the another room. The reagent preparation area should be under positive pressure to prevent the introduction of contamination. Sample preparation area should be under negative pressure to keep template nucleic acid in the room. Amplification and product detection area should be again under negative pressure to keep amplified nucleic acid in the room. A unidirectional workflow should be observed to reduce the chances for contamination to occur. No materials, supplies or equipment from the sample preparation room should be taken into the reagent preparation room. Similarly, nothing from the amplification and product detection should be taken into the sample preparation or reagent preparation room. Now, first of all, we will see the reagent preparation room. The reagent preparation room should be designed for the preparation and storage of PCR reagent. Preparation of master mixes and aliquoting of master mixes to PCR tubes should be performed in this room to prevent cross-contamination and to avoid repeated freezing and thawing. Reagent stock solution should be allocated into smaller volumes. To deter contamination, the room should be under positive pressure. The reagent preparation room should have a dedicated set of adjustable pipettes with plug aerosol barrier tips. laboratory coats and disposable gloves. Personnel should complete tasks in this room before working in the sample processing or amplification or detection rooms, and should not return from these rooms to the reagent preparation room. Sample preparation room. Now, the sample preparation room should be designed for sample processing. This facility should be used for allocating of samples and preparation of positive and negative control. As per the protocol used for extraction of nucleic acid, the required quantity of clinical samples should be added to lysis buffer and then transferred to RNA or nucleic acid extraction area. The processed samples and controls are then added to the tubes containing the PCR master mix in this room. PCR tubes should be capped as soon as the sample is added. Now, coming to amplification and product room. This room should be designated for PCR amplification and post-PCR analysis. The thermocycler or real-time PCR machine should be kept in this room. Gloves and laboratory coat should be worn at all times and removed before leaving the room to control amplicon contamination of other locations. All equipment used for amplification and product detection should be dedicated to this room, including adjustable pipettes with plugged aerosol barrier tubes. This room should be kept under negative pressure. Although PCR amplification and post-PCR analysis may be performed in the same room, these activities can be conducted in different areas or different rooms to reduce the risk of contamination from amplified products. Now, if you see the unidirectional flow of a PCR laboratory, first is the reagent preparation room where PCR master mix preparation and allocating will take place. The second is sample preparation room where a processing of sample, isolation of nucleic acid and addition of sample to master mix will take place. And the third one is amplification and product visualization room where PCR thermocycling, confirmation by gel electrophoresis where we use in conventional PCR, or confirmation by visualization which we use in real-time PCR should take place. So there, and in addition to this, there should be an independent entry and exit where the entry should be made into the reagent preparation room, a separate entry for the sample preparation room, and a separate entry for a post-PCR or amplification room should be available. Now, coming to the equipment in PCR laboratories, to ensure that pre-PCR and post-PCR events remain separated, each room must have its own separate set of equipment, reagents, pipette tips and racks used in that location only. First of all, we will see the thermocycler or real-time PCR machine. Thermocyclers are essential to PCR methods, and great care should be taken to ensure that they are well maintained and reliable. The block temperature of a thermocycler should be tested at least twice a year by the laboratory or under a maintenance agreement to ensure uniform heating throughout the block. This can be clubbed with calibration or preventive maintenance schedule. It should be done even if the equipment do not require calibration. Block temperature should be tested with an external probe that has been calibrated against a temperature standard. For testing, the probe is placed in several of the wells in the periphery and the center of the instrument. All the temperature should be within the manufacturer's specification. The amplification program used in each run should be printed to further verify the conditions of PCR. Coming to the real-time PCR, real-time PCR instruments are equipped to perform fluorescence excitation and detection to monitor amplification throughout the PCR cycles. The design is usually different from the standard thermocycler, and calibration may be specific to the instrument design. Calibration should include temperature, laser performance, alignment, and safety devices should be checked, and optical systems should be checked. The machine should be serviced annually. Real-time machine should be used with uninterrupted power supply, that is UPS backup, as this equipment is very delicate and sensitive, and also the laser needs to be protected from damage. Coming to the centrifuges, separate centrifuges including microfuges are required for pre and post PCR procedures. The manufacturer instruction for calibration should be followed. The centrifuge should be balanced before use to increase bearing life and minimize vibrations. Coming to vortex mixture, the vortex is important equipment required for reagent preparation in the PCR clean room and for nucleic acid extraction. Gel electrophoresis chamber, this equipment is used to detect the PCR products after amplification. Chamber should be inspected before use to ensure that electrodes and buffer tanks are intact and that power supply electrodes fit snugly. Gel electrophoresis chamber should be rinsed several times with water after each use in the designated product room. Pipettes, automatic, fixed volume, adjustable, positive displacement pipettes and micropipettes are used in the PCR laboratory. This should be calibrated quarterly by the manufacturer or a technician. Each pipette should be sterilized according to the manufacturer's recommendation on regular basis or whenever contamination is suspected. Now coming to the laminar flow hoods and the biological safety cabinet, which is one of the important part of the PCR laboratory to avoid contaminations. Laboratory users should pay careful attention to the specifications of the hood or cabinet to ensure that it is appropriate for its designated use by the laboratory. Here I have given the details of different type of cabinets and their use. So there are different type of cabinets, laminar flow hoods and biological safety cabinets. Here we will see one by one. First of all, there is a PCR cabinet type A, which has a UV light but it doesn't have an airflow system. This can be used only for reagent preparation purpose. The second one is PCR cabinet type B, where there is no UV light but intake filtered airflow system is present. This cabinet is not used for any aspect of PCR preparation. The third is PCR cabinet or type C or laminar flow hood. It has UV light, it has an intake filtered airflow system, and this can be used for reagent preparation only. Then there is a class 1 biological safety cabinet, where there is a UV light present, airflow system is present for exhaust filtered. It is not recommended for any aspect of PCR preparation. Then there is a class 2 or class 3 biological safety cabinet where there is UV light is present, intake and exhaust filters are present in airflow system, and this can be used for all aspect of PCR system. Class 1 cabinets have inward airflow and HEPA filters, exhausts that provide personal and environmental protection, but no product protection. Class 2 and Class 3 biological safety cabinet filter both air intake and exhaust and prevent contaminants from entering and leaving the hood, reducing the likelihood of sample and work area contamination. Before use, hood should be decontaminated using UV light for at least half an hour and cleaned with bleach or other effective nucleic acid inactivating agent. The airflow and HEPA filtration in all hoods should be monitored and certified as per manufacturer's recommendation at least annually. Now coming to the part of refrigeration, there are different type of refrigerators and freezers are required for storage of reagents as well as nucleic acid. So first of all, a refrigerator should be used for temporary storage of samples, extracted RNA or nucleic acid, and final amplification product in the respective laboratory. Usually, long-term storage is not recommended, but if needed, a separate deep freezer with a capacity up to minus 80 degrees Celsius can be maintained. Coming to freezer with minus 20 degrees Celsius, PCR clean reagents, enzymes, buffer, DNTPs, that means deoxynucleotides, and primers are required to be stored at minus 20 degrees Celsius. The primers and DNTPs and water should be stored in small aliquot to avoid freezing and thawing effect and also to rule out contamination issues. To verify that equipment is functioning properly, the laboratory should have a schedule for maintaining equipment. The schedule should include to set up, calibration, repair, record keeping, and normal operation of all equipment used in sample analysis. The results of all tests should be documented in an equipment logbook and or in electronic database. The logbook or database should be checked bimonthly by quality control personnel or the laboratory supervisor, and any problems and corrective actions should be managed. Equipment should be dedicated to a specific laboratory room, and instrument manuals from the manufacturer should be available at the place of use. Coming to the consumables, disposable materials used in PCR laboratory include pipette tips, sample tubes, PCR tubes, and gloves. To reduce the contamination and degradation of the target nucleic acid, disposable materials should be of good quality. Coming to pipette tube, a special attention should be given towards the quality of pipette tubes. Special tips for PCR analysis include barrier tips, that means filter tips, and aerosol resistant tips, both of which minimize cross contamination of samples during pipetting. These tips can be purchased pre-sterilized and pre-loaded in hinge rack to provide tip protection and easy access. Pipette tips for PCR analysis should be RNase free, DNase free, and pyrogen free. Now, coming to the sample and PCR tubes, polypropylene tubes that are certified DNAs, RNAs and pyrogen free are best recommended for PCR laboratories. The size and style of PCR tubes or reaction plates should be compatible with the block and lead height of the thermocycler or real-time machine. Thin wall tubes provide the best heat transfer, ensuring that the reaction volume reaches its specified temperature in the shortest amount of time, thereby improving specificity and reproducibility. The tubes containing stored samples and reagent should be centrifuged briefly before opening to ensure that all the liquids are at the bottom of the tube. Now we will discuss short about laboratory wear. Disposable gloves should be available in each section of laboratory used for PCR analysis. The gloves should be changed before leaving and entering each section of the laboratory and each time that contaminating DNA is potentially encountered. In addition to reducing potential contamination from samples, wearing gloves may protect the technician from potential chemical exposure and prevent sample contamination due to human DNAs and RNAs. Dedicated laboratory coats should be available in each laboratory room. The laboratory coats should be removed and gloves discarded appropriately before leaving each room. Changing laboratory coats and gloves reduce the possibility of contamination with template or amplified nucleic acid. The laboratory coat should be cleaned regularly to reduce the possibility of contamination of the designated workplace and the PCR reaction. To eliminate the need for cleaning laboratory coats, disposable, that is single-use laboratory coats may be used. Now we will see the details of reagent management, reagent storage and the quality checks of the reagents to be performed. The reagents used in PCR amplification can be purchased or prepared in-house. All reagents should be clearly labeled with name, expiration date, and relevant safety information. Reagents from different lot numbers should be interchanged or combined together. This should not be done to avoid the quality issues or contamination. Precautions should be taken to ensure that reagents are contamination free and storage conditions are well maintained. Molecular grade water or its equivalent from commercial sources should be used for all assays. Water purification systems that produce high quality pyrogen and DNA and RNA free water may be used. Diethyl DEPC treatment can be used to eliminate RNAs from plasticware and from water, which is required in RNA analysis. Reagent water is treated with a solution of 0.1% DEPC for several hours, followed by autoclaving to degrade the DEPC completely. Proper autoclaving is necessary because trace amount of DEPC in a solution will lead to the modification of purine residues in RNA by carboxymethylation. This leads to downstream effect in RNA experimentation, that is, removing the ability of reverse transcriptase to bind RNA and synthesize DNA from an RNA template. Commercially prepared reagent should be of molecular grade and be stored according to the manufacturer's recommendation. All reagents from new lot should be tested for lot verification to ensure that they work properly by running a PCR positive control using the new reagent. So a lot verification should be done with each lot of reagent received, and this can be done by running a PCR positive control. For reagents prepared in-house, criteria should be developed for expiration dates, functional acceptability, and storage conditions using product sheets from similar commercial products as a guidance. The criteria should be documented in the laboratory standard operating procedures. Buffer should be inspected for precipitates or microbial contamination before each use. Now, coming to the commercially available kits, many types of commercial kits are available for PCR applications. These products expedite and simplify procedures, such as the isolation of DNA and RNA and the purification of nucleic acids to remove contaminants. Now we will see about primers and probes or oligonucleotides. The PCR analysis require the use of short segments of chemically synthesized DNA. These are called oligonucleotides or oligos. Primer sets are oligos that are designed specifically to prime the amplification of a portion of a targeted nucleic acid of interest. Primers and probes containing a specific sequence of nucleotides can be obtained commercially. Certification of the quality of the oligos, including method of purification, purity, and concentration, should be required from all commercial manufacturers. Now, coming to the storage of oligos and template, it should be stored at minus 20 degrees Celsius or minus 70 degrees Celsius in either TE buffer or molecular grade water. Now, TE buffer is a commonly used buffer solution in a molecular biology, and it contains 10 millimole of TRIS-HCl and 0.1 millimole of EDTA at 8.0 pH. The TE buffer generally is the preferred storage buffer for oligos and DNA templates because it may prevent DNA degradation. The pure concentrated oligos should be stored in the original tube from the manufacturer and labeled with primer name and concentration. To minimize the chance of contamination and degradation, this concentrated stock should be used on a regular basis. Diluted working stock should be made for each oligo, and these working stocks should be used for all the experiments. Before use, oligo should be thawed and mixed completely. Now, coming to the enzymes. Enzymes are the critical requirement of a PCR system and should be purchased from a commercially sourced to ensure its purity. Quality assurance information with the enzyme should be obtained from the source. Each new lot of enzyme should be compared with old lot using known controls and samples. Storage of enzymes should be followed carefully. Enzymes are usually stored at minus 20 degrees Celsius and should never be left at room temperature. Insulated benchtop coolers or ice can be used to keep the enzyme cold in the laboratory when being used on the benchtop. PCR products may also be stored at minus 20 degrees Celsius or minus 70 degrees Celsius. RNA templates should be aliquoted and stored at minus 70 degrees Celsius. Now coming to the manpower requirement or the personnel requirement. Personnel working in PCR laboratory should undergo training in the methodology that covers PCR and recombinant DNA theory and practice. The coursework should also include biosafety in a PCR laboratory as well as quality issues and troubleshooting PCR related problems. Hands-on training should be completed for each technique under the supervision of experienced personnel. The time required for training will vary depending on the trainee and technique. Competency assessment and training must be an ongoing process. Personnel should demonstrate that they can successfully perform the method by testing confirmed positive and negative control samples before being allowed to analyze diagnostic samples. So, with this, I am completing the session here on setting up of a PCR laboratory. In this video, I have given a complete detail of infrastructural space requirement, equipment maintenance, calibration, specifications of the equipment, reagent specification, reagent storage and quality checks, laboratory wear for personal safety and avoid contaminations, training of the personnel, and the competency of the personnel that is required in a PCR laboratory. Hereby, I welcome all the suggestions and feedback on this topic. Also, you may ask any queries related for the setting of PCR laboratory on the phone numbers and email IDs I have mentioned here. Thank you all.